Assalamu alaikum. Today we will continue our tutorial on the tutorial 10, which is the first one is to discuss about the multiple choice question. Question number one. Okay. Blank states that the intensity of the plane polarized light that passes through an analyzer varies as the square of the cosines of the angle between the plane of the polarizer and the transmission axis of the analyzer. So for these questions, right, okay, we need to discuss that the question is contained with the analyzer. We know the analyzer is what? Okay, second polarizer. Okay, second polarizer, and of course we have the polarizer and the analyzer. Okay, meaning that two parallel polarizer, but between the polarizer and analyzer there is a square of the cosine. So this law that should be equivalent, or that should explain about the words of the cosines of the angle between the plane of the polarizer and analyzer is actually Malus law. Okay, Malus law. The answer should be C. Okay, no, it's not a Brewster's, it's not a reflection. The Brewster's is tangent theta. Okay, tangent theta. Right? The reflections of law is theta I equals to theta r, and the Snell's law is the sine theta I n1 sine theta 1 equals to n2 sine theta 2. So this is Snell. So the answer is a Malus law. Is Malus law states that I is equivalent to I naught. Okay, Malus law, I naught cos square theta. Okay, I naught equals to cos squared. I equals to I naught, and I is the intensity, and I naught is the original, the initial intensity. For the second question, a linearly polarized wave is always, okay, a linearly polarized wave is always, we have A in XY plane, B is always a transverse wave, C in YZ plane, and D is a longitudinal wave. So basically for option A and also option C, okay, it talks about plane, and we know that the polarized wave is always is contribute by the directions of the electric field. So an electric field can be in every axis, it can always be in every axis. Maybe it can start with the positive Z, positive Y, or positive X. It can be anywhere. Okay, so we cannot the linearly polarized wave cannot be in the plane, always in the plane. Okay, so this is the wrong answer. Okay, and now we left with the transverse and also longitudinal wave. As you know, that the we know that a linearly polarized wave is always transverse wave. Okay, and not the longitudinal wave, because longitudinal is like a caterpillar, a movement is like a caterpillar. Okay, right, the direction is it propagates forward, but it's not a longitudinal wave. Sound is a longitudinal wave, but not the transverse wave. Okay, so the answer of a linearly polarized wave is always a transverse wave. Okay, now is question three. A virtual, upright, and smaller in size of image can be produced by, okay, we have option A, plane mirror, right? Option B, a concave mirror, Option C is a blurry mirror, and D is convex mirror. So definitely the answers cannot be a plane mirror. So this is the wrong answer. Why? Because the plane mirror will give the exact size of image. So definitely it's wrong, because we need to get the image that is virtual, upright and smaller. Okay, virtual, upright and smaller. Okay, and it also cannot be a blurry mirror. Okay, so now the answer is just a concave or a convex mirror. And definitely we know that concave mirror will give you, okay, okay, concave mirror will give you a real image, and last but not least, the convex mirror will give you a virtual image. Okay, so this is a virtual and this one is real. And of course, we should know that the convex mirror is always, okay, is always have this kind of characteristics of image, which is virtual. Okay, because the image is the locations of the image is at the back of the mirror, okay, upright. Okay, when it's virtual, it's basically upright and it's smaller in size. So virtual, upright and smaller size. Okay, this is the only possible characteristics of image for the convex mirror. Okay, so and number four, choose the correct answers for the types of mirrors and their description. Option A is concave mirror, so it's a converging light rays. Okay, converging light rays. So this one is actually correct. Plane mirror, okay, diverging the light rays, which is wrong. Okay, plane mirror is also always produce inverted image, is also wrong, because plane mirror will give you upright image. Okay, upright image, and of course, considering that the object is also upright. Okay, if we put the object inverted, then the image is also inverted. Okay, but what means by in the word in C is actually based on if the object is upright. Okay, and D, the convex mirror always produce a real image. So convex mirror produce a real image is all wrong, because convex mirrors will always give you virtual image, okay, not a real image. So the answer is A. Okay, so this is the problem and solutions for chapter 24.9. We have first questions. Okay, three polarizing plates whose planes are parallel. Okay, whose planes are parallel are a center on the common axis. The directions of the transmission axis relative to the common vertical direction as shown in figure. A linearly polarized beam of light with the plane of polarization parallel to the vertical reference direction is incident from left onto the first disk with the intensity of I or initial equals to 10 units. Calculate the transmitted intensity IF, okay, the final intensity, when theta 1 equals to 20, theta 2 equals to 40, and the theta 3 equals to 60. So definitely for this question we have three polarizing plates. Okay, three polarizing plates. The first one, okay, is a 20. The second one, 40. And the third one will be 60. Okay, 20, 40, and 60. And then this is the I1, okay, which is 10. Then it, go through first polarizer, and then what is the IF here. Okay, so definitely IF is I1, I initial equals to cos square. Okay, the first one will be 20. Okay, cos 20, right? Okay, so this is the first theta because this is 20. So here is theta equals to 20 degree. Okay, and here we have the second one, which is between 40 to 60. Okay, so this theta is also 20 degree. Okay, this one is 0, theta 0 to 20, so 20, 20, and then the difference between 40 and 60 is also 20. So here, yeah, in this case, we want to find, okay, to get the IF, so we must get first let's say I put this as I1 and I2. Okay, what is I1? I1 is II cos 20. Okay, and give you the answer. Let's say the value is 10 cos square 20. Okay, meaning that 10 times cos 20 square. So this will be the answer. And from this answer, you can put it at I2. So I2 is what? I2 is I1 cos another 20, right? So this will give, let's say the answer for this part is A. So I give you A cos, because A is I1, okay, cos 20 square. Okay, this one. And let's say it give you B. So for I3 is I2 cos square 20. Okay, because I2 is B cos 20, okay, square. Why? Because 60 minus 40 equals to 20. Okay, so we need to get the difference between each of the polarizing plates. So the difference, okay, don't take the exact amount of angle. So we need to take the difference between the first polarizer and the second polarizer. Okay, so that is the correct answer. So that is IF. So IF is considered as cos square 20 times cos square 20 cos square 20. So in the end, the answer will be, okay, from the answer, the last answer is 6.89 units. Okay, so how to get that? So 10 cos 20 square dot cos 20 square, this one times here, times cos 20 square. Okay, and then you can get this one equivalent to 6.89 units. Okay, so question 2. Figure 2 shows an unpolarized light passes through two Polaroid sheets. Okay, the transmission axis of the analyzer makes an angle 35 degrees with the axis of the polarizer. Okay, remember, so this is about unpolarized light. So the unpolarized light, the direction is everywhere. Okay, it's not concentrate on the only one, only single direction. So this is the symbols of the unpolarized light. Okay, if you look at the malus, how the malus work, okay, when the unpolarized light, okay, encounter the polarizer, what happened? Okay, So when the unpolarized light, the intensity, let's say the intensity of the unpolarized light is I naught. So whenever it reached the polarizer, the first polarizer, now it become half. So I is what is 0.5 I naught for here. Let's say this is I1, and this part is I1, and this part is I2. So at I1, okay, the unpolarized light have become polarized. First it become polarized, and the intensity at I1 have become 0.5 I naught. That means it become half of the original intensity, right? So calculate the the question now is calculate the transmitted intensity of the original unpolarized light after passing through the analyzer. Look here, the analyzer. What is the analyzer? The second polarizer. Okay, the second polarizer. So we need to determine the transmitted intensity, the transmitted intensity of the original unpolarized light after passing through the analyzer. Okay, the question will can be asked to you. Okay, maybe after the polarizer, or and in this case, after the analyzer. So in this case, they want to know what is the intensity, the final intensity after it passing through the analyzer. So again, so first of all, calculate I1. I1 is what? I1 is 0.5 I naught. And I2, which is the final one, I2 is what? I2 is I1 cos square 35 degree. Okay, so what is I1? I1 is 0.5 I naught. Okay, because they want to leave your answers in terms of I naught, so we can define as I1 as 0.5 I naught cos 35 square, and the answer is 0.336 I naught. Okay, so the original the transmitted intensity after it passing through the analyzer is 0.336 I naught. Okay, in part B, the intensity, calculate the intensity absorbed by the analyzer. Okay, you can know this is the analyzer. Okay, so how many? So the incident is 0.5 I naught, and the outcome, the transmitted, the one that transmit after the analyzer, is 0.336 I naught. So what is the intensity absorbed by the analyzer? So to answer this question, we need to just deduct the intensity, or the delta I here is 0.5 I naught minus with the 0.336 I naught. Okay, because we want to see the how much the intensity is absorbed by the analyzer. So we know that the incoming, the incident light to the analyzer is 0.5. Okay, it comes with the 0.5 and it passed through only 0.336. So how many absorbed? So we need to deduct 0.5 to the 0.336. So the answer is 0.1641 I naught. Okay, so chapter 22.1 and 22.2. So number 3, two plane mirrors are at an angle of theta 1 equals 250, which is, this is theta 1. Okay, with each other as in the side view shown in figure. If a horizontal ray is incident on mirror 1, okay, this is mirror 1, at an angle of theta 2, okay, an angle of theta 2, does the outgoing reflected ray make with the surface of mirror 2? Okay, so we need to calculate the theta 2. Okay, what is the theta 2? at what angle theta 2 does the outgoing reflected ray make with the surface of a mirror? Okay, if you look carefully, mirror 1 and mirror 2 at the angle of theta 1, which is equivalent to 50. Okay, and based on our knowledge in terms of parallel ray, when you have two parallel ray, so the incoming ray is exactly falls on the theta alpha. This is theta alpha, and this theta alpha is actually equivalent to theta 1, which is equivalent to 50, and at the same time theta alpha is also equivalent to theta beta, which is also equals to 50. Now we have a triangle like this, a simple triangle like this. Okay. Okay. So this is theta 1. Okay. This is lambda. And this is beta. Now we know theta 1 is 50. And beta is also 50. And now we have to know what is lambda. Lambda is 180 minus 100 equivalent to 80 degree. Okay. Because of the H's. Okay. Remember, the law of reflection is stating that angle of incidence equals to angle of reflection. So if you do have a plane mirror like this, so we can see that. Okay, let's say this is incoming, so you can draw a normal line. So this is theta r, okay, theta I. This one is theta r. Theta I, angle of incident equals to angles of reflection. So basically, so for example, if you have alpha here, then of course it will equal to beta, because this is a straight line. Right, so if alpha is 50, then beta is also 50 degree, right? And based on our knowledge in terms of triangle, one triangle is equivalent to 180 degree, and therefore 180 degree minus 50 minus 50, then you get lambda equals to 80. And for that reason, okay, theta 2, which we want to calculate, is equivalent to lambda. Oh, sorry, a gamma. Okay, this is a gamma. Okay, so alpha, beta, gamma, and theta 2 is equal to gamma. Therefore, theta 2 is 80 degree. Okay. Okay, for chapter 23.1 until 23.2, right, we have number 4. A dentist uses a mirror. Okay. Let's say this is a mirror to examine a tooth that is 1 centimeter in front of the mirror. So basically, this one is P, or object distance. Okay, the image of the tooth is formed 10 centimeters behind the mirror. Behind the mirror, meaning that this is a virtual. Okay, determine A, the mirror's radius of curvature, and B, the net magnifications of the image. Okay, so basically, when this happens, so you can see that the image is formed 10 centimeters behind the mirror. Okay, 10 centimeters behind the mirror. So we actually cannot determine yet which type of mirror we are talking now. But on our experience, when you have a virtual image, which means the image is formed at the back of the mirror, okay, and so definitely this will be the convex mirror. Okay, maybe a convex mirror, that depends. Okay, so we put it first on hold in terms of the convex or the concave, but we know this is something that related to virtual image, because concave mirror also have image formed at the back of the mirrors. Okay, so first of all, we need to establish the mirror equation, which is 1 over F equivalent to 1 over P plus 1 over Q. Okay, so this is the general equation, but when stating here that we need to find in order to get the radius of curvature, we know that a radius of curvature is the 2 times of f, okay, 2 times the value of the focal length. So we need to establish the focal length with the use of object distance p and also image distance q. Okay, so object distance is at the back, in front of the mirror, so 1/1 centimeters. It should be in one. We should change this one to the meters, but because both are given in the situation is in centimeters, so we can always use the centimeters also. Okay, but the image form is 10 centimeters behind the mirror, so therefore the image the object the image distance is negative, so it can be, it should be like this, 10 negative 10, look at here. Okay, so this is positive, the general equation. Now it becomes negative because it should be right now as 1 over p plus with the negative 1 over q, because the negative comes from the negative q, right? So we can write down as this one, and 1 over f is equivalent to, right, 10 minus 1 over 10 centimeters. Therefore f is equivalent to, okay, 10 divided by 9 centimeters. Okay, so that is 10. So what is the radius of the curvature? Okay, what is the radius of the curvature? So r equivalent to 2 times f. Okay, so 2 times the 10 over 9 centimeters. The answer will be, okay, 2.22 centimeters. Okay, and the part B, the magnifications. Remember, magnifications is m equivalent to negative q over p. Maybe you can use this equation, or you can use height of the image over height of the object. Okay, but for the with the use of negative object distance and image distance, you must put negative. Okay, so negative, so negative, and q is also negative 10 divided by 1, so the answer will be positive. Okay, because negative and negative is cancelled out, 10.0, so the magnification will be positive 10.0. Okay, for question 5, at an intersection of a hospital hallways, a convex spherical mirrors is mounted high on a wall to help people avoid collisions. Okay, the magnitude of the mirror's radius of curvature is 0.55 meters. So this one is the radius of curvature, and okay, locates the image of the patients located. So part A, they want to know what is the locations of the image. So they want to find Q. Okay, so we need to use a mirror equation. 1 over F is equivalent to 1 over P plus with the 1 over Q. Always use the general equations. Okay, but in terms of the types of mirror, which is convex mirrors, so we know that locations of the object, locations of the image is at the back of the mirror, because the convex mirror will give you virtual image. Okay, always remember virtual. What means? What does it mean by virtual? The image is formed at the back of the mirror. At the back of the mirror, so the indicator is the Q must be positive negative value. Okay, Q must be negative value. Alright, so we know that from here we can get Q. Okay, because 1 over F. So how to get F? So from the radius of curvature, okay, radius is equivalent to 2f. Remember, focal length is r over 2. What is r? Okay, 0.55 and divide by 2 equivalent to 0.275. But remember, okay, the radius of curvature is negative. Okay, you must put negative because this is convex spherical mirror. So the answer for the focal length is 0.275 centimeters. Oh, sorry, meters. Okay, 275 meters. Alright, so that is for F. Then we can put here, okay, so 1 over negative 0.275 equivalent to 1 over, okay, 10 minus with 1 over Q. So the answer is Q is equivalent to, okay, after reduce to the we can you do some calculations here. The Q is equivalent to negative 0.268 meters. Okay, so for part B, indicates whether the image is upright or inverted. Indicates whether the image is upright or inverted. Alright. So in this case, the magnifications calculated here, okay, remember if we try to calculate it, okay, M is equivalent to negative Q over P, and we know that Q is negative, and therefore we will get a positive value of M. So the positive value of M indicates that this image is the upright, because it is a virtual image, so the image is upright. And how about C? Okay, determine the magnifications of the image. Okay, then we can use M equals to negative Q over P, so negative 0.268 divided by 10, so that will give you, okay, negative and meets another negative. Okay, so you give you positive 0.0268, okay, without units. Okay, last but not least, the additional questions. We have a concave mirror has a radius of 24 centimeters. So radius is 24 centimeters. And we know the F is 12 centimeters positive, okay, because this is a concave mirror. And determine the object position which the resulting image is upright and larger than the object. Okay, upright and larger than the object by a factor of 3. Okay, so for concave mirror, so the magnification is given by M equivalent to negative Q over P. And we know Q is the object is also a negative value, and P is what we will want to find. So in here, 3, we consider that the magnification is 3, yeah, provided that the Q is upright. When the image is upright, definitely it is a virtual image. So we can find that negative Q over P. So we can say that the Q is actually equivalent to negative 3P. Okay, Q equals to negative 3P, and by the use of mirror equation, 1 over F equals to 1 over P plus 1 over Q, then we can replace Q with the one that we use to say here, which is Q equals to negative 3P. So 1 over F is equivalent to 1 over P minus with 1 over 3p. Okay, and then you must replace, substitute the F equals to 12 into here, okay, into F, and then you may find that the P is equivalent to 8 centimeters, positive 8 centimeters. Right? Positive 8 centimeters. And how, this is for part A. And how about part B? Okay. Part B, draw a ray diagram to determine the positions of the image. Okay, so they want us to draw a ray diagram. So if you want to draw a drain, right, okay, you should use a ruler, okay, ruler and a, and use an appropriate way to consider the how to draw a perfect ray diagram. So we know this is a concave here. So this is a concave, right? So in here we have R, and in between we have F, focal length. The focal length is 12, and the P also, or the object is maybe slightly here. Okay, slightly here. Now we want to use another color to okay, we use, first of all, okay, draw a F ray. Okay, so parallel P, parallel ray, okay, parallel to the principal axis, and then it should reflected to the focal point. Reflected to the focal point, and then at this part, okay, at this part it will project to the one here. Okay, because it should be slightly in the middle, right? And then afterwards, you want to get to the C. Okay, use the C ray. So must go slightly over here, and it will okay go to this side, and this side it will points towards something here. Okay, and then this is where you will get the image. The image is upright and larger. Okay, the image is upright and larger because when you want to get to F, so that is C, and maybe if you want to use the F ray, so you need to extrapolate around here because F ray should give something like this. Okay, now the conditions of three okay, because I use the bare hand, so you cannot get the possible answers, right? So you now use your meter ruler to determine the value. Okay, of course in the mirror, okay, we need to use at least two rays to draw a diagram, which is number one is P ray and number two is F ray. P ray and F ray, and the intersection between P ray and F ray will give you image, right? And last but not least, okay, part C. Okay, the image, is the image real or virtual? Okay, because it's formed at the back of the mirror, so definitely the image is virtual. Okay, because when the image is formed at the back of the mirror, okay, it becomes virtual. Where else, okay, when it's formed at the same size of the image, then it is a real image. Okay, so I think that's the how we conclude the tutorial 10. And thank you for your attention.